He was the king of pop, and she was the princess of rock and roll. But when Michael Jackson and Lisa Marie Presley married on May 26, 1994, the news perplexed fans and the public worldwide, only adding to Michael Jackson's increasingly bizarre tabloid persona in the 1990s. But on the surface, the union would appear to be a natural match for the two stars, whose fame meant they experienced life like no other. As both grew up in the spotlight, both came from burdening family dynasties, and both lived life under intense media scrutiny. However, the showbiz marriage would be over in less than 2 years. Countless headlines and gossip column inches have been written about this power couple, but let's take a look inside the personal lives, the marriage, and the bedroom of Lisa Marie Presley and Michael Jackson. In 1974, a 16-year-old Jackson was introduced for the first time to a 6-year-old Lisa Marie Presley at the MGM Grand Hotel and Casino in Paradise, Nevada, by her father, Elvis Presley. With her father already a music sensation when she was born, Presley was raised in the world of rock and roll on the famed Graceland estate in Memphis. Elvis and Priscilla Presley divorced when Lisa Marie was 4, but she continued spending her time between Tennessee and Los Angeles, where her mother lived. Lisa Marie had been brought to the hotel to watch a show by the Jackson 5, as she was a big fan of the group. The young girl was particularly fascinated by lead singer Michael Jackson for his talent at dancing. He was a decade her senior, but clearly made an impression on her, and they stayed friendly. In the 1980s, Jackson even inquired about her to his attorney, John Branca, and was bitterly disappointed when he found out she had married her first husband, Danny Keough, in 1988. It wasn't until the early 90s that the two would meet again when Lisa Marie Presley was eager to pursue a music career and had already secured a deal with Sony. But she was scared to begin recording, to be compared to her father, and for it to ultimately fail. At the same time, Michael Jackson was launching MJJ Records, and their mutual friend, Brett Livingston, told him of a perfect girl for his label. He said she was young and beautiful, and her name was a marketing dream. When Jackson asked who, he told him Lisa Marie Presley. Michael Jackson requested for her demo tape, but Lisa insisted on meeting him in person. In November 1992, they met at a private dinner held at the home of Brett Livingston. Knowing that Presley had been looking for help within the music industry, Livingston had her play tapes for Jackson, who was impressed with Presley's voice. The pair talked for the remainder of the night until it was time for Jackson to leave. At this point, according to Livingston, the entertainer gave Presley, who was still married at the time, a penetrating look and said in a conspiratorial voice, "You and me, we could get into a lot of trouble. Think about that, girl." Unbeknownst to Presley, in hopes of receiving some sound advice from a pop icon akin to who she would be compared to in her father, Lisa Marie found herself unearthing a much deeper connection with Jackson. In the days following, Presley and Jackson spoke on the telephone almost every day, forging a strong friendship. The two came to realize they had much in common. Both had been protected and sheltered from the real world, and both were mistrustful of outsiders, having spent most of their lives feeling exploited by them. It is difficult to say what ulterior motive either one of them had at this time. No one could argue Presley dated Jackson to become famous, or that Jackson was interested in Presley because of her money. They both had everything, and at the same time, nothing to offer each other other than themselves, which was refreshing for both of them. However, it was the following year when Jackson became the subject of child abuse accusations that the relationship quickly accelerated. Presley, along with a few others, was there for emotional support. Jackson would call Presley from overseas as he embarked upon the second leg of the Dangerous World Tour, and the child abuse investigation intensified. During such telephone conversations, Presley attempted to reverse Jackson's sadness with humor and advice. Presley later recalled that she believed in the musician's innocence and that she could save him. Fueled by her past addictions and her father's death, Presley supported Jackson as he became increasingly addicted to painkillers, urging him to settle the allegations out of court and go into rehab. On her advice, he subsequently did both, becoming so vulnerable that he relied on her more than anyone during this traumatic period. With his image tarnished by the allegations and his album sales dropping dramatically, his then-manager, Sandy Galyn, pressured him to do some damage control and get married so as to improve his image. During this time, he talked to Lisa Marie nearly every day on the phone, and it was during one of Jackson's calls to Presley that he proposed marriage. "If I asked you to marry me, would you do it?" the singer queried. Though still married to actor Danny Keough, whom she had two children with, Presley replied that she would. After a pause, Jackson exclaimed that he had to use the bathroom. Having apparently relieved himself, the singer explained to his new fiancée that his love for her was genuine and she had to believe him. In 2010, Presley acknowledged to Oprah Winfrey that Jackson did formally propose one day in his library, taking out a 10-carat diamond ring and getting down on one knee. The stability of marriage appealed to Michael while he was facing possible prison time, when his life, career, and health was turned upside down and inside out. Following several months engaged, Jackson and Presley wed on May 26, 1994, at a ceremony in the Dominican Republic. Presley had divorced Keough by having it fast-tracked 20 days before. The 15-minute ceremony was held by Judge Hugo Francisco Alvarez Perez at his home in the La Vega province. The union was conducted in Spanish and translated for Presley and Jackson by an attorney. Perez recounted Michael Jackson's behavior during the ceremony. "He stared at the floor. He looked lost. He looked so sad. My assistant and I kept pulling him aside, asking if he was okay. When I pronounced them, he acted like he didn't want to kiss her. She had to grab his face and kiss him." At the time of their marriage, the press and public were unaware that the two even knew each other. The wedding was kept secret from them, Jackson's family, and Presley's mother, Priscilla. However, Gotham Chopra recalled that Jackson called him in a panic on his wedding night and asked if he had any bedroom advice, wanting to make sure that Lisa was impressed with his moves. Upon being informed of her daughter's marriage with Jackson a week later, Priscilla became irritated. She believed the male pop singer was using her child to rehabilitate his image following the child abuse accusations. To the press, however, Priscilla stated that she was very supportive of Lisa Marie. The union was met with a mixed reaction from the media when it was made public 2 months later. Some sources described the union as being the marriage of the century. One newspaper headline scoffed, "Jackson Presley Union sparks shock, doubt, laughs." Addressing both the media and public, the new Mrs. Presley Jackson issued a statement. "My married name is Mrs. Lisa Marie Presley Jackson. My marriage to Michael Jackson took place in a private ceremony outside the United States 11 weeks ago. It was not formally announced until now for several reasons. Foremost being that we're both very private people living in the glare of the public media. We both wanted a private marriage ceremony without the distraction of a media circus. I am very much in love with Michael. I dedicate my life to being his wife. I understand and support him. We both look forward to raising a family and living happy, healthy lives together. We hope friends and fans will understand and respect our privacy." For the newly wedded couple, they divided their time between Jackson's 2,700-acre Neverland Ranch in Santa Ynez, California, and Presley's 4,000-square-foot estate 100 miles away in the Hidden Hills. Although they spent a lot of time together, Presley did not move into Jackson's home upon getting married. According to biographer J. Randy Terabarelli, this was due to her wanting to remain independent, as well as Presley's children, Danielle and Benjamin, finding their new stepfather a little strange. It was reported that they weren't intimate physically during their marriage. However, Lisa Marie has repeatedly stated that they were, telling her best friend he is hot stuff in bed, that he liked her to wear jewelry in the bedroom, and that they would engage in role-playing games. But her friend expressed disappointment when Lisa Marie would never tell her which role he would play. Having been brought up in showbiz, Presley was used to what others might call strange. When asked if Jackson wore makeup in bed, she confirmed and stated, "I don't have any problem as long as he's happy." Looking back, Presley has said, "One of the very highest points of my life was when things were going really well and he and I were united together and I could take care of him." During 1994, when Michael Jackson was not promoting or on tour, the couple were allowed privacy and were as solid as any healthy marriage. It was when the two were required to appear in public together when Jackson felt the pressure to repair his public image in order to save his superstar musical career that tensions between the two rose. The pair first appeared together on television at the 1994 MTV Video Music Awards in what has been described as a memorable moment. Holding hands, the couple walked onto the stage in New York. In front of a television audience of 250 million, Jackson announced, "Just think, nobody thought this would last," before embracing Presley in a kiss. Afterwards, Presley became angered at her husband feeling he had used her. The pop singer reasoned that the lip lock, which was dubbed the kiss of the century, would be talked about for decades, with people playing the clip over and over. Jackson's attempt at calming his wife proved futile, and she told the singer not to even come near me and remained angry for several days. The intensifying tabloid press also caused issues, as in the same week, Jackson and Presley had another argument. News reports had been suggesting that if Elvis were alive, he would not approve of his daughter's marriage. Annoyed, Jackson reportedly suggested that the couple could find out by holding a séance to contact the deceased king of rock and roll. Presley felt the idea was tasteless. The two supposedly never spoke of the incident again. Jackson and Presley appeared on the television show Primetime in June 1995. In Jackson's first interview since 1993 and Presley's first ever, Diane Sawyer quizzed the pair on their private life with a series of insensitive questions. Presley boasted that she and Jackson had regular sex following Sawyer's questioning their sex life. When asked if the marriage was a sham, Presley asserted that such rumors were crap. She said she would never marry someone for any other reason than being in love with him, and concluded that if the public thought differently, they could eat it. The following day, Presley reflected that the interview had been a disaster. She had hoped the couple would be perceived as being serious, yet Jackson fooled around during the show, at one point holding two fingers behind his wife's head to make bunny ears. Presley's friend Monica Pastel revealed that it was at this point that Presley began to wonder whether she had made a mistake in choosing Jackson as a long-term partner. Initially, Presley felt that Jackson was vulnerable, a child himself, and needed to be taken care of, a role she indulged in. But once married, when Michael gained emotional stability, he became who he was again, the strong-minded, stubborn, and ambitious person that got him to where he was. He didn't like to be told what to do and would say to Lisa, "What I do is none of your business." He made it clear that she had to be okay with whatever he does and not question him, but support him if she loved him. But Lisa was not okay with that, as she was concerned and also proud. One issue the couple had was that Jackson was desperate to have children right away, but Presley was unsure and wanted to wait. Imagining the future and what would happen if the marriage ended, Presley saw an impending custody battle nightmare. In addition, she felt her husband was too emotionally immature to be a parent. Having watched his daily interactions with other people, she believed he was the one in need of parenting. Jackson explained to his wife over breakfast one morning that she did not have to be the biological mother if she so desired. He explained, "My friend Debbie Rowe said she will get pregnant and have my baby. If you won't do it, then she will. How about that?" Unshaken and infuriated with his persistent threats, Presley replied that it was fine by her. When asked on tape if Lisa Marie ever asked him to adopt her kids and give them financial support, Jackson said, "No, she didn't. I never asked her because she already said in an interview that they had their father, that other guy. But I also wanted to be their father, officially. She didn't want it." Michael Jackson said himself that Lisa was good doing hospitals with me, but she got real angry when I wanted to visit two children who killed this other kid in prison because I believed they didn't have a childhood. But Lisa didn't understand it. She thought I was rewarding bad kids. Lisa Marie admired Jackson's commitment to charity and giving back, but felt he also overdid it, wanting to give love to two murdering kids and heal them. It was an illusion, a fantasy of his, that he could do that. A further problem for the pair was Jackson's insistence on being around children, though she believed he was innocent. "I wouldn't let him near my kids if I thought that. She felt her husband was only opening himself up to more rumor and innuendo following the 1993 allegations, and that he was leaving himself vulnerable, that opportunists would blackmail him and threaten him in exchange for money. Following several more troubled months, Jackson ended up in the hospital after he collapsed while rehearsing for a concert in New York. It was around this time Presley suspected Jackson had relapsed and his drug addiction was getting out of hand again. There was just an occasion, an incident where he had collapsed and he was in the hospital. It was very confusing what was wrong. Every day there was a different report, and I couldn't really get a straight answer about what was happening with him. And I think we were all a little bit in the dark. At that point, I think I got from various indications that that was going on then. There were times when I would pick him up from certain doctor's offices and he would not be coherent, Presley recounted. Presley arrived at the hospital to meet her ill husband, and yet another heated debate ensued. The argument ended after Jackson warned her that she was making his heart rate go up and asked her to leave. She obliged and was escorted out by a doctor and Jackson's mother, Catherine, along the way. Presley subsequently returned to Los Angeles, and after being discharged, Jackson went to Disneyland Paris to recover. They both had suffered from drug dependency, and Michael was beginning to use medication to numb traumas relating to the allegations. Lisa was in recovery at the time and feared for her own sobriety. She stated in an interview that she did everything in her power to support and help him get into recovery, but he was unable to beat his many demons at that time in his life. Presley filed for divorce in early 1996, citing irreconcilable differences and noting their date of separation as December 10, 1995, shortly after the incident in the hospital. The divorce was finalized on August 20, 1996. As part of the settlement, Presley received 10% of the royalties from Jackson's History album. After his divorce with Lisa Marie Presley, Michael Jackson was truly heartbroken and told one of his friends, "She was my only one shot. I fear I will never have that again." Even though he quickly remarried Debbie Rowe in order to have children, staff at his Neverland Ranch observed that he had no pictures displayed of his new wife, but rather a picture of Lisa Marie as a kid stood on his nightstand, dating back to the time when they first met in 1974. However, he eventually realized he had to move on. He had several music projects in development, and soon after their divorce was finalized, Jackson was scheduled to go on a world tour. Although the two were legally divorced, that didn't stop the unlikely couple from making several attempts to rekindle their romance in the years to come. As Presley refused to carry Jackson's children, friend and the assistant of his dermatologist, Debbie Rowe, offered to give birth to a child for the pop singer, an offer that was used against Presley throughout their marriage. Shortly after Presley and Jackson's separation in January 1996, Rowe became pregnant but suffered a miscarriage in that March. The event devastated Rowe, who feared she would never be able to have a baby. Jackson comforted and consoled Rowe throughout the ordeal, which remained hidden from the media and public. Jackson embarked on the first leg of his History World Tour in September 1996. 1 month into the tour, and several months after his divorce from Presley, Jackson's personal life made headlines as it was revealed that Rowe was pregnant with his child. Jackson and Rowe wed on November 13, 1996 at the Sheraton on the Park Hotel in Sydney, Australia. The night before the wedding, Jackson had called Presley, who gave him and Rowe her blessing. The news of pregnancy had obviously come as a shock, as she never imagined that he would choose the tomboyish Debbie Rowe as his wife and so quickly move on from their relationship. She was perplexed to how she got kicked out of his life so fast when she once had a say in everything. She knew Michael too well to know that he was paranoid, distrustful, and would not become intimate so easily with this woman when she spent so much time peeling away his layers. Lisa Marie Presley went on to hang out with Jackson's mother and his sister Janet to find out more about Debbie Rowe. When Michael found out about this friendship, he called Janet to find out if Lisa Marie was angry. However, Janet said Presley held no grudge against him and would actually like to meet him. His heart raced. He called Lisa Marie and said, "I really love you, and I hate the way it ended between us, with us saying mean things to each other." even after Debbie Rowe gave birth to his first child on February 13, 1997, Jackson and Presley rekindled their romantic relationship as she quickly became the artist's main focus once again. Presley was seen with Jackson in various cities during the History World Tour in 1997, notably at various functions in South Africa and in London, holding hands backstage and around the city. In February 1998, they were photographed in an intimate moment together outside a Beverly Hills restaurant on Presley's birthday. But one thing Jackson made clear over and over again was that he didn't need her advice anymore. Presley really didn't understand at this time what to make of this and wondered if he really loved her. Their on-off relationship was fueled by Lisa Marie actually chasing Michael, sending him letters that read, "I will give you 9 children if you want. I will do whatever you say." But Michael saw she was too strong-minded and didn't want trouble anymore. He had his children and didn't see the need for a wife. Presley said that they spent 4 years after the divorce getting back together and breaking up, stating, "I don't understand the relationship I had with him." Lisa Marie Presley resurfaced in 2003 with her debut solo album, To Whom It May Concern, which became a top 5 hit. Despite the widespread skepticism about the validity of her relationship with Jackson, Presley steadfastly insisted their marriage was genuine, if unorthodox. To promote the debut album, she again sat down with Diane Sawyer, who pulled no punches in her questioning. "Michael Jackson? Why did you marry Michael Jackson?" Presley hinted that the private Jackson was very different to the man his fans knew. "First of all, he's not stupid. He didn't get to where he was by being stupid. It's unfortunate that not a lot of people know who he really is because he doesn't let anybody see it. If he wants to lock into you, and he wants to intrigue you and capture you, and whatever he wants to do with you, he can do it. I fell in love with him, I did. Everything I said was the truth." According to Presley, the last coherently good conversation she had with Jackson was in 2005. She replied that she was indifferent when he asked if she still loved him. At the end of the conversation, he reportedly told her he felt that someone was going to try to kill him to get a hold of his catalog and his estate, and even named some names that she has yet to disclose. After his death in 2009, Presley drew parallels between the lives of Jackson and her father Elvis in an interview with Oprah. That they had the luxury of creating whatever reality around them they wanted to create. She said Jackson constantly asked her about the details of Elvis's death because he felt that he was going to end up the same way. She also told Oprah, "There was a very profound point in the marriage when he had to make a decision. Was it the drugs and the vampires or me? And he pushed me away. I still try to figure out why. What is it that I had to go through this twice?" Even though Presley said she felt indifferent towards Jackson, in death she realized he loved her. Lisa Marie gained a better perspective on the paradox between Jackson's authentic love for her and his actions in public, which often used Presley to boost his public image. Lisa Marie said, "He was conditioned to get himself where he needed to go for his career and with his talent. He became very good at puppeteering and manipulating to some degree." Presley continued, "I was always confused by that manipulation, thinking that that manipulation meant he didn't love me. I understand it better now. The manipulation was because it was a survival tactic for him."